purpose of my research is to study brain aging. That's what I've been doing for the past many decades. And the way I approach that in the past has always been to get compounds from drug companies, chemicals, molecules. And they have gone nowhere. As you already know, obviously, we don't have a cure for aging. And my focus of my research has been on Alzheimer's disease. We don't have a cure for Alzheimer's. So clearly, we don't have good models because we don't have very good diseases. And so I, like many of my colleagues, have given up on trying to find a magical molecule from a drug company. We're going to things like food. You know, the reason we are is because, you know, what the epidemiologists have done for us is they've interviewed individuals in their 70s and 80s and asked them questions, sir or madam, you're not demented, why? And, you know, they give you really insightful answers of the most immoral things. And so what you're going to hear me say as I go through tonight is that virtually everything immoral and illegal, except where I was in Denver last night, is it legal here? Oh, all right. Okay, good. Okay, wonderful. It's not in Ohio, and it never will be. long story there, but anyway. Thank God, because that's, yeah, I've signed that in books, smoke more pot. But essentially, what people tell us is they say things to us that they've been drinking a lot of beer, they had whiskey every day, or they smoke cigarettes, you know, a whole pack, two or three packs a day. And we hear these things, and we wonder, does it make sense? And so people like me who has become frustrated and examining experimental drugs have started to pay attention to the epidemiology when it comes to aging, because there are things that we're learning now from people. It's almost a proof of concept that people are manipulating how their brain ages, and well beyond that, they're manipulating how they feel. And a lot of the examples that I'll use, and even in the Q&A, they're going to sound very familiar to you, but now we're beginning to unpack some of these things to explain psychoactive drug effects. And you know, and before I was talking about how something as simple as nutmeg, if you were, and this is never usually part of my talk because no one's going to do this, so I'll just tell it to you. Essentially, on the way home tonight, stop at the grocery store, buy an entire tin of nutmeg, put it in some applesauce, that's the way my students use it, and actually consume the whole thing. For about 48 hours, you will hallucinate on ecstasy. So your body converts a completely inert molecule called myristicin, which is in nutmeg, into a synthetic compound that does not exist on this planet, ecstasy, and you will hallucinate. And it's a long-lasting hallucination. And you will pay for it. You'll have diarrhea for 2 weeks. If there's anything that's going to demonstrate there's a gut-brain relationship, that does, you know? But way ahead of myself here, because we got off on these great conversations before. Let me begin by saying, you know, the title of the book is a play on words. Obviously, your brain on food is what you all learned about your brain on drugs. And the point of the book is right here. Foods or drugs or chemicals. And the amazing thing is that's so obvious, but nobody ever seems to believe it. And people behave as though they don't think it's the case. So when we, you know, nutmeg's a great example. Usually I use chocolate, but let's go with nutmeg. You know, is it a food or a drug now? You know, who can say? For a lot of my students, marijuana is part of their diet. You know, I have 3 or 4 of them every semester that come to class high. One guy does because he has anger management issues, and we're really glad he's high when he drives, because he would be in an accident. He'd be one of these road rage people. So they're always self-medicating themselves, and the interesting thing is they come to me sometimes, and they'll say, look, I'm feeling depressed, I'm anxious, not sleeping well, and I suggest maybe you might want to talk to your parents and talk to a doctor about getting on an antidepressant. And they'll say to me, no, God, no, I don't want to be diagnosed as depressed. And that stigma arises. But then they'll go and get some herbals or some omega-3 and some valerian root or whatever herbal thing and eat that. And it's not going to be as effective. The interesting thing is that people tend to view drugs as dangerous, not natural. And they view herbals or foods as natural and safe. And the point of the book is simply to say, look, there's really no distinction. They're all just chemicals. They do good things for you and bad things for you. And you'll see as I go along that some things that you consume all the time that are horrifically dangerous for you are incredibly neuroprotective. And from interviewing those 80-year-olds, we discover that some of them were crazy enough to smoke cigarettes and then lucky enough to smoke cigarettes. It depends on who you are. And that always plays a role, and that can't be ignored, your genetic background. So I always encourage my students, and it's true for all of you, what was true for your parents? Because how food's going to affect you is going to be somehow determined by your genetic makeup. One of the things that happened when this book came out is I started getting emails from women, especially women, who were suffering with chocolate anger. I mean, for most of us, chocolate is a fun food. We don't see it as something that's going to make us upset. But if you carry a genetic vulnerability, the aggregate effects of all the molecules in chocolate are going to have a psychoactive effect on you. You're more vulnerable than maybe your neighbor. So what are your genetics like? What have you inherited? You know, and for the most part, we can't tell you for some of these things. But that's where the title sort of alludes to, that foods and drugs are identical. You can become addicted to chocolate and coffee and cocaine, and we now understand, really only in the past 10 years, that the neural mechanisms that underlie you becoming addicted to heroin are identical to you becoming addicted to chocolate or sugar or anything else. It's just a quirk of how our brain works. We love fat, salt, and sugar. Our bodies evolved in an environment that never was exposed to fat, salt, and sugar. Those things are very rare. In fact, now we know the cities in England that end in the word witch, W-I-C-H, like Norwich and Greenwich and all those things, that refers to salt. So whenever people would find a salt deposit, they'd settle and gave it the name. Salt place, and then it had another name attached to it. So these don't occur very often in nature. They do for you, but they never did during the evolution of your brain. And so that influences what we're attracted to today. We love fat, salt, and sugar, and your brain loves it. And that brings me to one of the most important points in the book, and that your brain's going to frequently ask you to do things that your body would prefer you didn't do. You know, and you all, yeah, right, we all know that. And we think, oh my God, I have some failed moral character because of it. Not at all. It's just the way your brain evolved was to do two very simple things. So let me actually get into that and introduce another valuable and important player to all of this. So this is you. You're a bag of chemicals. And every day, you dump in some salt, some fat, some cocaine, some caffeine, whatever it might be that you put in your blend, and this is you every day, right? And this is how we tend to view ourselves. And that particular blend, as we assume, determines how healthy we are. And sure, it does, but there's a lot more going on here. First of all, this isn't just simply you, right? There's a couple of things that I need to point out. First of all, you're a feeding tube, really, and that matters. Because feeding tubes, the sole job of you is to absorb, chemicals in your environment to survive. And so like any other feeding tube on this planet, and everything is, this could be a worm, we put our nervous system, so I'm going to draw a brain right up here, at the front end of the feeding tube. Have you ever wondered why your brain's in your head, not, safely ensconced inside your spinal, or your rib cage where it could be protected? It's because it evolves at the front end of feeding tubes. It's that way for hydras, it's that way for bugs and flies and cats, dogs, everybody. You put it there. So that, and then the other thing you do is because foods are chemicals, you put some chemical sensing equipment up here like a nose or chemical sensing equipment like a tongue. And actually, we know you have food sensors all the way through your gut because your stomach needs and your intestines need to know if you've eaten a lot of sugar or protein. It actually literally tastes it and tells your brain, we better slow peristalsis and give you a little bit more time to get the nutrients out. Your feeding tube's job is to extract nutrition, right? That's it. So the job of you as a feeding tube in your nervous system is the following. One, survive. Try not to end up in anybody else's feeding tubes. And two, make more feeding tubes. We call them children, right? So that's the idea. Now, I don't care whether or not you've got a fin or you've got some appendages that move you around. The rules hold. You must extract energy from the food you consume and all the foods I'm going to do that all night long, just get used to it, is that we consume, like every other single cell or multicellular organisms, we consume the energy out of carbon bonds. And so you as a feeding tube have one job. Take in whatever you want, carbon, as protein, carbon, as fat, carbon, as sugar. It doesn't matter, all right? Your job is to get the energy out of the carbon bond, the energy. So you got two carbon atoms, they're bound together. All organisms do the same thing. You break it apart, you gobble some of the energy out of the between the bonds, and then you have a problem. You've got carbon debris. And the solution about 3.5 billion years ago was that you just bring in the most common available gas, oxygen, and you get rid of the carbon, CO2, and that's what you all do. We eat and we blow off CO2. I'm explaining all this because as we understand the rules that guide the design, there is an interaction between brain size and gut size. You all know you have big brains. We don't have really big guts, but we have really efficient guts. So in evolution, guts got bigger and longer, but there's only so long it can get. I mean, men have 21 feet, women have 22 feet on average. Why women have more, we don't know. But the idea is that you get the nutrients out. You have another problem. The carbon that comes in is debris. You need to get rid of it. You don't want to build it up and so forth. So we bring in the oxygen, but the oxygen is incredibly toxic. You all learned about hemoglobin in high school. The hemoglobin carries oxygen in. Well, the real job of hemoglobin is to keep the oxygen levels in your body low enough that you aren't outright killed by it, which is why all of you who are these little, my little sacks of chemicals, we are all covered in two things, dead skin and mucus, right? There isn't anything else. Why? Why are you covered in dead skin and mucus? I mean, there's all this is mucus, and everything else is dead skin. It's to protect you from the oxygen that's out here. It's that toxic to us. And so your job is to get this energy and then to protect yourself from the oxygen that you must take in to get you to not die from the oxygen you're breathing. That leads to something that I study intensely, which is aging. The most important thing that determines whether you're going to die is how long you've been alive. Well, that's obvious, right? Really, you look at the charts, and I see that same phrase. The highest correlation of death is how old are you? Why? You ever wondered about why? Why do old people die? What is it about death? When you look at me, you can tell I'm older than other people in the room. You look around, you can tell that some people are younger in the room. What on earth are you looking at? What are you doing every day that makes you age? Every day. It's you breathe oxygen in. And the reason you need the oxygen is because you consume food. So you do that every day. And every organism has to do it. It's survival, right? But the survival ages you. So the very act of living kills you every day. In fact, why do you die? Because the oxygen that comes in is not perfect. You do have some residual oxygen, and it forms things that we call, I'll just say it, free radicals. This is drying up on me now. Free radicals, and free radicals are essentially oxygen that's turned into a hyperreactive molecule, and it's toxic. Okay, so anything you can do to breathe less oxygen is a good thing, but you get to a point the ideal then for aging is to take in as few carbon bonds as possible. The only thing that I point out in the book that allows people to live a long time is to eat less food. We've now known this for 50 years, that caloric restriction is the only scientifically proven way to slow the aging process, because every day you eat and breathe to survive, all right? That's why everyone has such a problem with food. You've got to eat it, but it kills you. This is just an accident in a way. It's unfortunate that we have to have oxygen floating around in us, but we do. The iron in the hemoglobin picks it up. I should also point out that some animals actually use magnesium, and they have blue blood, we have red blood. And which brings me to another point. You've all seen the movie Avatar. That's what we should look like. Why? Well, let me explain to you what else is going on here. You take in 100 calories at the front end of your feeding tube. What you find inside the feeding tube is a really interesting group of organisms. So when you look at you as a big organism, you're not just one cell, are you? You're about 70 to 100 billion cells. They're big cells. So if you stand in front of the mirror tonight, you're looking at 100 billion cells. But also, along for the ride that we're beginning to appreciate is vitally important to you is the human microbiome, bugs. There's 100 trillion of them in you. 100 trillion. That means when you stand naked in front of a mirror looking at yourself, there's 1,000 of them looking back at you for every single one of you that's not human. You know, I mean, the saying of, you know, that you're never alone, you're not, you know where it comes from. So they're all in here. And the reason we're beginning to pay attention to it is actually going to be an answer to questions that I know are going to come up. because these guys that live in your gut, when you eat, they eat first. And we don't think about that. So when you take in your 100 calories, you don't get it first. They do. There's a lot more of them in there than you in terms of mass. Yeah, they don't weigh as much as you, but there's a lot more of them. So every day they are fighting for food, your food. Every time you take a medication, they get it first. So what they do, though, is they give us things that we need. So 80% of all the proteins in your blood, and we didn't know this until last year, 80% of all the proteins in your blood are actually presented to you, provided to you by these bugs. So when you consume some food, they convert some molecules into vitamin K and vitamin B12 and things that we call vitamins that we must have, and lots and lots of other vital proteins. If they died, so would you. And then what we're beginning to become concerned about is that, A, they play a role in aging. What role do they play? And then we frequently get sick and treat ourselves with antibiotics, which kills a weird percentage of them, you know, and we don't know the consequences, but beginning to notice that there are consequences. In children, we're worrying that giving them an antibiotic treatment may actually predispose them to asthma and peanut allergies and lots of other things we're beginning to worry about, that we keep screwing up the balance. Now, it's already messy in there. Every day, half of all the bacteria in your body die because of bacteriophage viruses that kill them. That's a good thing. Otherwise, you would quickly disappear in bacteria. So they're always fighting each other. Most of your covering and some of the inside is fungus. And so what we do sometimes is we discover that people will cause imbalances that can be very bad or very good. Let's pick a good one. So one of the most popular foods that people like to eat is red wine. We just had some over there. You've heard that red wine contains resveratrol. Well, you know, it's in low doses, but why on earth is resveratrol even good for us? Well, back to the bugs, it turns out what resveratrol is, it's the grape's antifungal. It's not there for us. It's there to protect the grape from fungal infections. And we eat it, and it hits our fungi and apparently must do something good for us, but we don't understand what it is. I'm trying to figure that out now. We've given individuals in studies, healthy individuals, probiotics to see if that helps people. Mostly what we see is the probiotics just come out this end. But the interesting thing, and that should happen, but while they were in you, now let's think about that for a moment. Probiotics, you buy them, you can get 8 billion cells, or the elderly version, or for elderly subjects, is 15 billion, and it's usually just two bacteria, the Bifidobacteria infantis and the Lactobacillus. 15 billion. There's 100 trillion of them. You are not going to even be noticed from this pill. That's like one extra person walked in this room. A part of an extra person walked in this room. It's not noticed. But people take probiotics because they think it might help. It helps a little. What we found in this study, just to finish the story, I'm transitioning into a bad thing from a good thing, but probiotics are good and bad, and that's always the case, right? So what we found in this study is that the women who took it did lose all the probiotics out in the through the feces, but what we found was that in their blood there were some other proteins due to those the bacteria and their probiotics. One of them was good. What we found is that the women reported that they were statistically happier. They felt their mood was elevated. Well, that's a good thing. But in addition, when they did other testing, we found that those same women had cognitive impairments. They were a little dumber due to the probiotics. What would you like, though? And that's always... I know, that's always going to be my question to people. I get these things all the time. People ask me, well, I want to live a long time. Okay, this is what you need to do. But would you like to be healthy while you're living a long time? Would you like to get off the couch while you're living a long time? And you see that some of the things I'm telling you leads to consequences that are both good and bad. So now that you've heard about the bugs, let me go back to the carbon again, because I'll tell you where this gets a little crazy. So I said the best thing you can do is stop eating carbon bond energy, because every time you do, you make free radicals. So right now, if we're here an hour, we know that you're going to take two full lungfuls of air and the oxygen in that air, and all the molecules in that two full lungfuls will be converted into free radicals. The longer you sit here, the more you age. You know that already. The reason you're aging is due to oxygen and the free radicals they form and the inflammation they produce. And so what all of you attempted to do tonight for dinner was to what? Eat antioxidants. It's like the resveratrol study. Colorful pigments in our food protect us from the free radicals. This is why you keep hearing put a plate full of, you know, colorful fruits and vegetables, you know, and eat that. That's what you're doing. You're perfecting the oxygen-free radicals from hurting you. The plants make them to protect themselves. Think about this. If you're an apple, you're sitting out there in a tree, bathed in oxygen. What are you going to do? Cover yourself in a pigment. It's red. Who cares? It could be any color. This is why if you want to get the best of an apple, eat the edges of it. The center isn't that useful. But so if color matters, that means that eating things like melons or bananas are pretty much a waste of time, and they are. You know, a lot of sugar. But so the recommendation then is eat things that are really colorful, because that means that that plant has been busy defending itself, and you get to eat that protection like resveratrol or colorful pigments, you know, in spices like cinnamon or you know, berries and cherries. That color is what you're going for, to protect you from the oxygen that's toxic to you, because you must use it to get the energy out of carbon bonds. That happened, you know, 4.5 billion years ago. This is the sequence we got stuck with. Now, what's the extension of this? Stop eating so much. We know that's true every other day, but primate studies in the past couple of years have demonstrated that we don't have to push it too bad. All we really have to do is simply take in fewer calories, maybe a third fewer. That's enough, just a third fewer. So the question then becomes, what third would you like to cut out? And so the answer to that isn't as simple as you think, because the other thing about you as this creature, this feeding tube on this planet, is that you're evolving on a planet that's spinning. Biorhythms play a huge role. We never really appreciated until a couple of years ago. I mean, we knew they were important, but when it comes to food and diet, it matters too, because these guys are subject to it, and so are you. So the point I want to make, and that comes, that I tried to make in the book, was that you're not just a blast furnace. You're not just burning carbon energy. It's more complicated than that. It turns out that you have a biorhythm. So if you have to go in for surgery, the doctor likes to do surgery early in the morning because you're less toxic to anesthetics in the morning. Same person at 11 p.m. might die from the same dose. Our biorhythms determine how well we absorb nutrients, how vulnerable we are to toxins. So why wouldn't it be true here? And it is true. In a study that was done in two different publications in the past year, what they found out was that people who ate big breakfasts were not as hungry, they performed better during the day, and you all probably told your children to do the same thing. We're trying to get young kids in grade schools to do this. But the approach now is that eat breakfast like a king, lunch like a prince, and dinner like a pauper. And we now understand that if you are on a standard biorhythm where you get up at 6, 7 o'clock in the morning, go to bed at 11 o'clock at night, the best time to eat all of your calories is at the front end of your biorhythm. You won't gain as much weight, and you will be wider awake. And people always tell me, yeah, but I'm going to be hungry for lunch. And in the studies we've done with normal, healthy people, that's not the case. So if you eat 800,000 calories for breakfast, a big, complicated breakfast with simple sugars and complex sugars and protein and all that stuff. I mean, my philosophy is just to be an omnivore, but because I don't preach any particular, you know, diet. If it's a gimmick and it works for you, go for it. If you lose weight, it doesn't matter. Just don't hurt yourself. You know, like the Atkins diet. I mean, some of my physicians' friends are on that, and they know it's killing their kidneys and livers, but they're saying, well, but I'm losing weight. Yeah, your kidneys are shrinking, but anyway. So it's always a trade-off, but so I just, you know, be an omnivore. But what we've discovered is just push it all at the front end of your feeding cycle, because if you don't, if you take the same person a 2,000-calorie diet and let them eat it all at dinner, the way most people do in the West, then you gain weight. We have obesity, metabolic disorders, insulin resistance, and so we can see it in animals, we can see it in humans. It's not that hard to say, but it's really easy. It's really hard to do. I mean, in our culture, trying to just stop eating at 4 o'clock, which is what we've discovered seems to be the key, and have a minimal dinner, yes, you're gonna go to bed hungry, but you're a very plastic organism. You'll get used to it. You can get used to anything. You're gonna wake up hungry and eat that big 1,000-calorie breakfast. You will not gain as much weight. Okay, so biorhythms play a role, but also how many carbon atoms do you take in? So a lot of my students are athletes, and some of them eat 3,000-4,000 calories a day, and they look like Adonises. You know, they're built, and they're muscular, and they're healthy, and they're strong, and they're energetic, and because of that, they're going to die sooner. Because according to this, if you take two genetically identical individuals, and you fed one of them 4,000 calories a day, and the other one, let's say, 1,200 calories a day, if you're simply asking me the question, who's going to live longest, the person that took in the fewest carbon bonds lives longer. But, you know, take it to the extreme. You're going to have muscle atrophy. You're not going to have any weight-bearing exercise. You're just going to be laying on the couch, have enough energy to watch Oprah and Dr. Oz. I was on his show a couple years ago before he went crazy. But anyway, that's another story. He's don't go to him for heart surgery. So the idea is that if you did do that, you'd become osteoporotic, you'd become weak, and you would have a terrible quality of life, wouldn't you? So this is the trade-off. If you want to be aerobic and have a good cardiovascular system, and if you want to, you know, have muscle strength to move around in your world and enjoy your life, you can't take this to the extreme. You have no choice. You're going to age and die, but you can slow it down. All right. So my advice is moderation in everything. So be an omnivore and just, you know, eat all your calories in the morning and a little aerobic, a little weight-bearing exercise. Other than that, don't overdo it, because we weren't built to lose energy via our muscles. Unless you're going to be an Olympic runner or a decathlete, the amount of calories that are left over here for muscles is minimal. So where do the calories go? Back to the bugs in this thing. You took in 100 calories, 70 of those calories are used by the bugs in you. So if you ever wonder who's eating all that food, you can probably hear them chewing at night, you know. They're in there, and they get it all because there's so many of them, all right? The rest goes to the other most important thing that we do, which is procreation, so the gonads. So there's two things that demand energy from the few calories we get back. If you're gonna have survival, you need to have a smart brain. That gets about almost 30%, about 28% that's left over. And the gonads get the rest. Whatever is left over goes to the muscles and any other tissues that might be available. So getting the energy out of your food ends up burning up the bulk of the energy of the food you consume. The rest of it goes to the single two most important things: make more feeding tubes and survive. There's an interesting trade-off. Because we can't make really, really big guts, we had to trade something. And so this is one of the things I got into in the book, the gut-brain relationship. It turns out that in an evolution, as the brains got bigger, the only thing that could suffer, the bugs aren't going to give up their energy, so the only thing that suffers is reproduction. So primates and all of you, only you don't have litters anymore. You have one child, right? Or two at the most, unless you do something really unusual. But in general, one or two. So our reproductive success is lost because of our big brain as it evolved. That was the trade-off we made. So because you are essentially, so if you just view yourself as a feeding tube with sole purpose of survival and reproduction, and you have this big, expensive brain, that's what you lost, okay? But we're doing okay. But we don't, you know, as an organism. But we're not doing as good as the viruses and bugs in us. They're doing incredibly well. In fact, they don't even know we're here. The interesting thing is that now we're beginning to appreciate is that when they're imbalanced, that's what we call sickness. But we're getting now to expand this. I don't want to go over too far here. We're starting now to pay attention to these bugs and what they do for us. And we're beginning to appreciate the fact that if you eat too much and take in too much oxygen, you develop something called inflammation. It's a low level of inflammation, but it affects the thing I study, which is aging. And that takes me to why I'm studying foods, because foods are very good at making anti-inflammatories and antioxidants. In fact, antioxidant properties are in anything that's colorful, and anti-inflammatory chemicals are pretty much in everything that's out there because they're defending themselves from the oxygen-induced inflammation. So inflammation is something that's in us, and the reason it's important to me is because I study Alzheimer's and aging, and it turns out that as we get older, there's more inflammation. But now we're beginning to understand that the role of inflammation is tied to what we're eating. So let me start with a simple one. If you eat and eat and eat a lot, your whatever ball of stuff is going to get bigger, right? We put down fat. Now, there's three phases in our lives when we lay down, when we actually divide and make more fat cells, usually just before puberty, and then usually in our teenage years, and then there is a proliferation of fat cells. So you really don't make fat cells that often. What we really do is when we get fat is the cells we have just get bigger. So unless you're going to undergo liposuction, you never really lose fat cells. They just get bigger and smaller, all right? But the one thing that we've learned about these bugs and fat cells is that they communicate with each other, because fat's a wonderful source of energy for bugs and you, right? So what we've known for many years is that individuals who are very obese tend to become depressed. And that relates back to this feeding tube in your brain again. But we never understood why people who were depressed were so hard to treat. Obese people who are depressed don't respond to antidepressants very well. And of course, they're carrying a lot of body fat where the drugs can hide. But it's more than that, because we now understand that if they lose weight, the depression goes away. So most depression spontaneously remits. What psychiatrists call depression is the common cold of mental illness, because everyone gets it, and if you left them alone, it would go away, but since doctors are lawsuit averse, they're gonna give you a pill. And we've often wondered, why do these pills work? We call them serotonin reuptake inhibitors, but now we appreciate the fact that they have nothing to do with serotonin. So back to the obesity, it turns out that every fat cell you have in your body releases these hormones, adiponectins, they're called leptins, and they're pro-inflammatory. So being fat induces the release of inflammation, pro-inflammatory proteins. They get into the brain, they get into the other organs, and so carrying a lot of body fat leads to metabolic syndrome, diabetes, and we've known for many years that being diabetic puts you at risk of getting Alzheimer's disease. Being obese puts you at risk of getting Alzheimer's disease. But we also know that being short puts you at risk of getting Alzheimer's disease. And so are they related? Epidemiology is not cause and effect. Because we also know that people who are tall don't get Alzheimer's disease, so maybe there's something to that. All right, so if you're a tall person, we also know there are gender differences here too. And I'll come back to those in a moment. But essentially, being obese produces, the individual fat cells release inflammatory proteins that get into your brain and cause your brain to age. And now we understand that anything that produces inflammation or makes it worse, like you might have inherited a bad gene, is going to put you at risk of a disease. So people get Alzheimer's disease not because their brains are inflamed, but because they've inherited a genetic predisposition and then the inflammation makes it worse. So maybe you grew up in rural Kentucky around insecticides and pesticides. That is the biggest risk factor for Americans to get Parkinson's disease. But we know that the insecticides, pesticides, produce inflammation. And they're very fat soluble, so you inhale them and they stay in your fat for a while and they make the situation worse. So inflammation due to the obesity gets into the brain and interferes with your brain's function as it causes the brain to age and become impaired. And just in the past year, studies have been done of individuals who are obese to find out what we already know in animals, that those inflammatory proteins make our animals dumber. And when we do studies in people, the more obese they are, the more cognitively impaired they are, all things being equal, no matter what their age. And if you lose the weight, you actually get smarter on performance exams. This is amazing. It's okay for obese people to be happy with how they look and so forth, but now we understand that it's very dangerous, in fact, to be obese. So fat ages you, and then ultimately fat determines why you die. So what disease you might be vulnerable to, what gene did you inherit? So I always tell my students, talk to your parents, find out what vulnerability you have. Maybe you're vulnerable to chocolate anger or something like that, but maybe more critical than that. Okay, so obesity due to all of that fat sitting there got there because of all the carbon bonds you ate and all the oxygen you brought in, so that together produces oxidative stress and inflammation. So what's the solution? The solution could be that you would just stop eating so much or lose the weight, and that's what we tell people. This is what you hear all the time. But nobody wants to do that. You know what's easy? If you're a heroin addict, it's really easy to give up. I can say that, but it's easier than losing weight, because if you're a heroin addict, you can just avoid heroin. But if you want to lose weight, you can't avoid food. You've got to eat to survive. So there's no avoiding food. This makes it really, really tough. So the solution is, try and find simple solutions. Well, if you're genetically vulnerable because of a gene you inherited from parents, we know that predisposes you to obesity. But so do these bugs, back to them again. Now what we think we're doing is that we give children a round of antibiotics to treat some disorder they had that may have saved their life, but we doomed them to asthma, autoimmune diseases, or obesity as we treated their bacterial infection. But you can see the challenge. You know, what are you going to do with a six-year-old who has measles or mumps or something that could kill them? You don't want to think about, well, they might become obese, but I'm going to save their life first. That's the challenge that we have. How do you make these decisions for long-term of what obesity is going to do because of what these bugs do? So the bugs, if you imbalance them, can set you up for autoimmune, lupus, asthma. We're beginning to wonder how many more diseases are out there that are going to make people be obese, because if you become obese, then you're going to accelerate your aging, and then you're at risk of Alzheimer's disease. So we can see a very tight correlation between getting obese, developing diabetes, metabolic syndrome, and getting Alzheimer's disease. And it isn't just AD, it's also Parkinson's and other diseases. So the other option is to just eat colorful foods, fruits and vegetables. This is what you also hear all the time. The reason is that those colors prevent you from exposing yourself to the oxygen. Okay, so that's part of the story. The other part of the story in all of this is, why on earth do men always die before women? This always comes up. Gender issues related to aging. So what we have to do is take a small cell here and go back in time 3.5 billion years again. When, if you imagine yourself, close this off. So let me open this up one more time, sort of just lay out the story. What always comes up when we do aging research is we almost always do studies on males because it's easy. The female studies are tougher to do. But the interesting thing about women is that when they have functioning ovaries, brain inflammation is irrelevant to them. It's fascinating. You take out the ovaries, or the woman goes through menopause, and they become incredibly vulnerable to the inflammation. Ovarian tissue is awesomely protective to women. So if you can avoid menopause, do it at all costs, you know. But that's not even possible. You can see that, you know, these things are easy to say. These are impossible things to do. I mean, if you're a short person who's obese and you're going through menopause, whoa, you know, what are you going to do with yourself? So, but then the question comes up, why aren't the men suffering this? Why are women so often getting Alzheimer's disease? Yeah, we know they live longer, but it isn't just us. You know, people often think it's because men are, they live dangerous lives, they, you know, bungee jump and ride motorcycles, and it has nothing to do with our behaviors. If you're a fruit fly and your average length of, you know, life is 5 days, the women live 7. You know, it's that way for wherever there's a gender, the males die sooner. And that's tied to all of this, believe it or not. So let me unpack that too, because this answers some really important questions that go beyond obesity. It's just who dies and why. So 4 billion years ago, everything on the planet were these single cells, and the cells would get bigger and bigger. They'd split down the center, and you'd make 2 daughter cells. You got that in biology before. So it's just, nobody died. You just got bigger and bigger, and you split 2 daughter cells. There was no death. There was nobody to step on you. There was just no death, probably, right? Unless you got killed by UV radiation or the oxygen that was forming. But then one day, what happened is an ancient form of bacteria invaded one of these cells, and that archaea had the ability to make energy, ATP, which is what I'm writing. ATP, which is, you learned in high school biology, is the energy molecule you need to move around. You make it from fat. You need it to move for, you know, enzyme activity. It's critical. And the A is cool because the A is actually adenosine that you use for your DNA. Okay. So this happened, we think, about 4 billion, 3.5 billion years ago. Now you have a cell that is able to make a lot of energy. This became the prokaryote. This became what you all are. This became what we call mitochondria. The reason we must use oxygen and forces you to age is because one day we got mitochondria and death occurred on the planet. So mitochondria allows us to undergo sexual reproduction. There's no more getting bigger and splitting down the center. What you do is, you know, you divide your DNA and the meiosis and all that, shuffling the DNA. We have sexual reproduction, which is hugely advantageous to shuffle up the DNA when you trade things. So when sex appeared on the planet, so did death. All right? They come together. Some of you are wondering about dating behavior. Anyway. So what happens then is that mitochondria allowed us to be really efficient, get bigger, much bigger, like your size, bigger cells, not like the stupid, simple bacteria viruses. We could be big and energetic and do things and live as group and multicellular organisms, and the mitochondria made that happen. But the mitochondria demand the oxygen. That's the reason you need it. So if it wasn't for them, you couldn't be multicellular. But if it wasn't for them, you wouldn't die. All right? That's another trade-off. but you get to be big and complicated and live about 117 years or so. Now, what happened though, let's expand this a little bit further. Sexual reproduction, let's just go to humans, it makes it easier. And what I'm drawing over here is a big cell in an ovary. Eggs are the biggest cells that women have. They're very large. They contain lots of mitochondria in them. And so a sperm comes along and carrying in its head maybe 8-10 mitochondria for energy for the tail to get in there. What happens is that, and you all know this probably, is that all the mitochondria that all of you inherited come from your mother, because the ovaries have a lot of mitochondria. But now let's go back 3.5 billion years ago. The mitochondria were archaea, they were bacteria. And what bacteria do is when somebody invades, they kill the invaders. Well, the sperm doesn't carry that many mitochondria, so they're immediately ganged up on and killed. This is why you never see male mitochondria in any of you. Moms always win. So we inherit all of our mitochondria from mom. So that was another trade-off. So if you ever wondered why on this planet there's only two sexes, there can only be two sexes. It's either this one's mitochondria or this one's mitochondria. That's it. So on our planet, we're pink and we have males and females, two sexes. So you can imagine you could go to another planet where they might have picked up manganese, like the limnless does, you know, that creature on the shores of the Atlantic and Pacific, and be blue-skinned, blue-blooded, and have 10 sexes for all we know, 10 different mating pairs. But on this planet, we're pink and we have two sexes, right? And that's why. It's because the mitochondria brought in the ATP and needed oxygen because it was available. Very simple, but it doomed us to death. But we got sex from it. You know. Anyway, you decide, right? Okay. So this is where we are today. These are the things we're beginning to appreciate of what it is about food. You eat and take in the carbon bonds, and you age because of it. And the only way you can not age is to take in colorful fruits and vegetables to protect yourself from the oxygen. Or you can just not eat in the first place. So this is the first part of the book. As I go through the rest of it, then the idea of the book that I had in mind was to take it another step further to say, okay, now you've learned about how you got here in this particular problem or circumstance. How do the foods actually affect your brain? And I expanded it to include drugs and spices and things like that, because this is what stuff my students ask me questions about. But the next step then is, well, how do they affect you? And you know, so now you can see why you choose the items and why you're told to choose the items that you do to protect yourself. And people always want to live longer, right? But the answer, although simple, is very, very difficult. But fortunately, it's not that hard. You get to still eat your 2,000 calories, just please eat them all for breakfast. But now, I want to go to breakfast for just a moment. I do it. I'm going to go over 5 minutes, because this is going to explain why Starbucks is out there. If you've ever wondered why Starbucks is out there, it's due to those mitochondria. So I know, and I love this story. I get so much hate mail because of this. I get a lot of hate mail. I've had people write me and tell me because of my marijuana work, they're looking forward to my death. I do things to support its use. It turns out that marijuana is an incredibly effective brain penetrating anti-inflammatory, and is estrogenic. I'm off story here, but it's estrogenic. You remember in high school, the little fat boys who got man boobs when they smoked dope? Remember those guys, right? That's why, because estrogen, marijuana has the THC is estrogenic in its action, so it's gynecomastia producing. And if you have a little body fat, you got breasts when you're 16 years old. Who was guilty of that? Anybody get man boobs? Never mind, all right. So the one thing that you're doing, let's go to the brain now. And I want to leave up the ATP for just a moment and go into the brain. One of the things that you do, which explains the whole ATP thing, is that here is your brain, terrible, ugly brain. But anyway, you have some neurons in your brain, and I'm not going to go too far with this, but some of those neurons, they release the transmitter acetylcholine. And acetylcholine's function in your brain is involved with learning and memory. And so one of the main reasons I wrote this book, too, is to help you understand your brain by looking at how these foods and drugs affect you. So it's a two-way street. You don't just understand the drugs and what they're going to do to you, but it's nice to look at what the foods and drugs do to you and then go, wow, now I understand my brain a little bit better. So let's just deal with one that everybody deals with in the morning, because I want you to eat a lot for breakfast. And so essentially acetylcholine is acetyl groups and choline. Sorry for my terrible penmanship on the right side here. Acetyl comes from sugar, and choline comes from lecithin, baked goods, things like that. So when you wake up in the morning, what you have been doing for the previous 3 or 4 hours is you've been dreaming. We all know this. You know, the alarm clock is about to go off and you wake up and you go, oh, I was just dreaming. Then you fall back asleep, you dream some more. So in the hours between like 3 a.m. and 7 a.m., you do most of your dreaming. Now, your brain's very active when you're dreaming, which means you're going to need a lot of ATP. And you burn up a lot of ATP. And when you burn up ATP, you end up with a lot of A debris, adenosine. And the adenosine actively turns off acetylcholine neurons. We won't get into why, but it does. So your ability when you wake up to pay attention and learn is impaired because you've been so busy dreaming during the previous 4 hours. So if you ever wonder, why am I so drowsy and why can't I be as perky, you know, as I am like right now? Because you've been busy dreaming, your brain was very active, you burned up all that ATP from your mitochondria, and the A debris interferes with acetylcholine. So the other thing that's happened is that you haven't been eating for the past 10 or 12 hours. You've been fasting. And the only energy molecule your brain cares about is sugar. Your brain can't really tell how much fat's in the blood, how much protein's in the blood, but it can tell how much sugar's in the blood. So it notices that blood sugar is very low. So you wake up in the morning, and this is the situation. The alarm clock goes off, you barely stumble out of bed, and your glucose, or your sugar levels are very low, and your acetylcholine levels are very low, and your adenosine levels are very high, interfering with acetylcholine. So this is what you want to do. You want to go and find a very simple source of sugar to make acetyl, a simple source of lecithin to make some choline, and we know those as donuts. The other thing that you want to do is you want to quickly get a molecule into your brain that antagonizes adenosine potently. Crosses the blood-brain barrier. The most effective drug for doing that is caffeine. If you ever wondered why Starbucks and all those other places are out there, it's because you want them there. You go to them because your brain knows, has learned from trial and error, this is what you need. In the morning when you wake up, because you've been dreaming, you've just been doing what your body does naturally. Remember I said at the beginning, your brain's going to demand things that your body would prefer you didn't consume. This is one of them. Those places wouldn't be there if your brain wasn't working the way it does, all right? So donuts, you make more acetylcholine, caffeine, you prevent the inhibition of acetylcholine activity. Now, all of a sudden, you've had your donut and your coffee, and one of them is not enough. Yeah, coffee's okay, put some cream in it. Or we'd like to have simple carbohydrates and, you know, or high glycemic drugs, or sorry, foods. And we know how, yeah, right, it's the same thing. We know how bad those things are. You're warned about it. They are bad for you. But from the brain standpoint, your brain's job is to help you survive, and that's to wake up quickly. So simple, high glycemic foods and coffee, tea, are what your brain needs. All right, so that explains why those things are there. If we didn't consume them, they wouldn't be selling them to us, all right? So a lot of this is a give and take. So what we find out then is that we use molecules in our diet in response to the demands of our brain chemistry, you know, from moment to moment as it changes, as we live and survive, okay? So now that we've looked at the impact of a mitochondria entering a cell 3.5 billion years ago and its role with oxygen and the transmitters in the brain that need the same nutrients that our feeding tube is consuming, we're beginning to understand such complicated things is like, why are obese people so hard to treat when they become depressed? And why when they exercise do the depression go away? It all ends up being the same answer because 3.5 billion years ago we got these mitochondria and demands we use oxygen and the oxygen is toxic to us and it produces inflammation and that leads to the whole aging thing. So there wouldn't be two sexes out here, you wouldn't be aging, you know, so this explains why men die sooner. So it also explains another really interesting thing. We've known for decades that people who get arthritis in their mid-40s tend not to get Alzheimer's disease. So the reason is that arthritis sufferers take a lot of anti-inflammatories. And those anti-inflammatories antagonize what's going on because you're eating and breathing. So if you're lucky enough to get arthritis, you're not going to get, you know, so the other things we've learned is that why is it that people who smoke cigarettes never get Parkinson's? Parkinson's disease is due to an inflammatory condition that lives in your brainstem for decades. In fact, now we're pretty good at diagnosing in males especially whether somebody's going to get Parkinson's disease in a 20-year-old male 40 years later. Now, we also can diagnose Alzheimer's in a person who's 30 with 95% certainty. But you are never going to be offered these things. We are beginning to understand them, but just because I tell you, look it, you're going to get it, doesn't mean we can cure it, unless you want to do some of the things I've been talking about. So, you know, maybe smoke marijuana. We also know that those old people told us that they drank a lot of beer, not red wine, because beer raises HDL, which reduces inflammation. So all of a sudden, the epidemiology of those that I started this with, of the individual who's 80 years old and isn't demented, he says, these are all the things I did. So the ideal circumstance then is to be a tall, thin, premenopausal woman with arthritis who smokes dope, smokes cigarettes, and drinks beer. And how many are there out there, you know? And that woman better eat a lot of donuts and coffee for breakfast. That's the ideal circumstance, you know? And that sounds crazy. But this is what the science is beginning to tell us. So what we have to do now is translate this into something that's reasonable, that your physician won't just laugh at. You know, I've been telling medical students and neurologists for decades now, if you have somebody who's in a terrible car accident, has a severe head injury, we now know that they're at risk of getting Alzheimer's disease because of the brain inflammation that forms. It isn't due to the fat, it's due to the injury. So the best thing they can do is to bathe their brain in a brain-penetrating anti-inflammatory. That would be marijuana. But is a doctor going to tell you after a car injury, start smoking dope heavily? No. They're very conservative. It takes physicians decades. We preach it to them, but they don't listen to us. So, you know, they are conservative in their approach, but there are things that we can do. Today, we can diagnose Alzheimer's with exquisite accuracy and prediction, but you're not going to get it, and no one's going to offer it to you because it's too expensive, and the medical community doesn't approve of the things that we're discovering, because you know what, it's just in rats. But it's more than that. The epidemiology is telling us these things, that it's the proof of concept may already be there. So I'm gonna stop now, but the purpose of the book was to say, look, foods or drugs or chemicals, treat them the same way. Recognize that you can understand how they interact with each other, with the bugs that live in you and your genetic background, and explain how you age and why you age the way you do and what's going to happen to you, because we all wanna know that. All right? Okay, I'm going to stop there. Thank you. And we can take questions. Okay. I know I've ruined most of you, and if you have children, you're lucky now you didn't bring them, right? Because terrible advice. Yeah, questions, please. And if you're not on the microphone, I'll just repeat it, but please go ahead.
Hi.
Hi there.
Since sugar, fat, and salt are addictive, how do you end the addiction to those single-serve half gallons of Dreyer's mud pie ice cream?
You can't, can you? You know what? And your brain rewards you for doing that. It isn't just that your body needs them. You know, we now understand you release endogenous opiates and endogenous cannabinoids, marijuana, when you do that. And in fact, it begins at birth. The contents of that ice cream milk, the casein in it, is converted to beta-caseomorphine, which is an opiate. So the first day we suckle at our mother's breast, we get a hit of heroin. So that the next day you want to go, I'm going back there. You know? Can you imagine what it's like to be a one-day-old child being shot with essentially heroin? You know, this is why kids, you know, are always going back to mom. That's the problem. From day one, thank your mother, that's the reason you like that ice cream. We just get addicted to the milk. And so now, cows. Now, the thing is, your gut-blood barrier closes off to beta-caseomorphine after about the age of 4 or 5. But we still drink milk. But you can imagine if that didn't happen. You know, cows would be precious, you know, things hidden away in the back room, you know, that we'd all be abusing and marrying or something, you know, in a different planet. But you can see where this goes. But that's the problem. Eating that fat, salt, and sugar blend, which is exquisitely designed by Ben and Jerry's to make sure that you're going to come back and do it again. They're there to make a profit, not to make you live longer. That's the problem. And now, what's made it worse, has anybody ever tried the fat-free pastries, and you know, you eat them, and they're all carbohydrates, and it tastes kind of gooey and chemically? In a few years, that's gonna all go away. Last year, we discovered that your tongue has a fat receptor. No one knew it was there. We knew about salt and sugary and sour, but it turns out that we actually evolved a fat receptor. And the chemical companies are now designing food additives that you're gonna eat, and it's gonna taste like pure fat to your tongue. It's just gonna make obesity even worse. That's the problem, but it's gonna sell products. So you're gonna taste fat-free things that just taste incredibly good. It's just gonna make it worse. But you know, we live in a capitalistic society and they wanna sell this to us. Anyway, go ahead.
Hi, I'm interested in the role of bariatric surgery in weight loss.
Sure.
And I've heard that that actually changes the amount of hormones the brain secretes and how that all works. And so I'm trying to understand, an addiction to food is the one kind of addiction. With every other drug, you kick it, you stop it, and you never consume it again. But food, you don't have that luxury.
No, it's terrible.
And so I was wondering how bariatric surgery might affect cravings. Do the cravings change? How does it change the brain in that sense?
That's a really important question, because we're turning to that quite often, bariatric surgery, and there's two answers to it. One involves, does it work? Does it last? Because like liposuction, we know that for most people, they just start eating again and they gain it back. And what we're finding statistically now, I just saw a report on this, was that most people who have the lap bands of bariatric surgery do gain the weight back. It's a muscle, your stomach expands.
Yeah.
You just simply you adjust, and over a period of year, most people really do gain it back.
Now, I am talking about the gastric bypass.
Sure. Either, okay, I was gonna go there too. The problem with a gastric bypass goes back to the bugs.
Mm-hmm.
Because what you've done is you've distorted their population. And we don't have an answer for this.
Okay.
The only thing I've seen thus far is that the gastroenterologists are now concerned that they're doing something that's setting up a condition where you're not going to be as healthy. You may be losing weight, but you're not healthy anymore, because we took out a whole population of bugs. Mm-hmm. And you would think that it would all be the same, but you know, the front end of your foot has a completely different population of bugs than the back end of your foot. It's certainly true of the gut. And so I think the answer there is stay tuned, but it's probably bad news.
Okay. Well, and the other thing, you were talking about eating most of your food earlier in the day.
Yeah, yeah.
And I know with gastric bypass, you have to consume more protein than anything else.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And all day long.
Right, because it's hard for you to get. And the problem is that it's like you shrunk your gut. And
mm-hmm.
so you need to give it time rather than giving it large volumes. And we always say that anyway, if you can just keep the blood sugar levels up slowly, that's why we like to suggest complex carbohydrates,
mm-hmm.
because you don't get that peak in insulin and so forth. Yeah, that's the idea. Just keep the levels low. And that's really good advice. So eat slowly early in the day and keep eating, and then stop at 4. Maybe that's the best advice. But
okay.
Those studies have not been done. The studies thus far are always with quote-unquote healthy people.
Yeah.
Because, you know, and that's what I had to focus on in the book, because there's always exceptions to this. You know, I'm not for supplements, but if you need something because you don't absorb it, especially after bariatric surgeries of all kinds, you got to take them.
Yeah.
Because you lose the part of your gut that absorbs them. Or you may lose the bugs that make them for you. So everybody's going to be a little bit different. But, you know, it's like gluten. If you're sensitive to it, avoid it. If you're missing B12, I mean, like in Ohio, as you get older, most people need B12. And they need vitamin D, because we're not in the sunshine. So all those things get layered onto this. All things being equal, I can give you an answer. But then each individual and their environment changes the answers. And then we go ahead and we cut out a piece of intestines and bypass it. Oh my God, the complexity is awesome. And then every time we try and do these things, we fail. This comes up every time. Why don't we do this? It fails. Let me just take a moment to explain. This is the most famous example you'll never hear of how we screwed it up really badly. You know, one problem with obese people is that they have a lot of fat cells, and those fat cells just don't release pro-inflammatory cytokines, proteins. What they also release is really interesting. We got these stories from people who were severely obese. They'd say, I'm doing just fine, and then at 3:00 in the afternoon, I get this severe munchies, and I eat 3,000 calories, you know, 5 bags of chips and sodas and so forth, and I was doing so good. What the heck happened? And we began to pay attention to that, and we noticed that due to a signal, we have not determined what it is yet, that what happens is that fat cells produce anandamide. Anandamide is your brain's endogenous marijuana. It's actually made out of fat, so it's really easy for fat cells to make it. And for a reason we don't understand, if you have more fat cells and they're bigger, some signal says release anandamide. And so you get the immediate munchies as though you've been smoking marijuana. So what a company in France decided to do, Sanofi Avanis, they invented a drug called Rimonabant. And Rimonabant had one property. It blocked the endogenous marijuana receptor. And the people in the study loved it. They lost weight. They lost their addiction to cigarettes, to alcohol, to everything. You can imagine the dollar signs rolling in the eyes of these drug companies. This is going to be that drug that you could take, and you would lose your appetite. No more munchies. You would be very, very healthy. And then something terrible happened. We learned, and this is why I said at the beginning, studying the effects of drugs and foods in the brain teaches something about the brain. Well, this did. It turns out that if you block your brain's endogenous marijuana receptors 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, you lose the ability to feel any kind of happiness whatsoever. You can't laugh. You pick up your child. You don't really feel any joy from it. The individuals in the study, as they were losing weight, losing their addiction, started committing suicide at a really high dose. So what happened is last May, the drug was withdrawn from phase 3 trials. It was almost ready to be released to the world, and they had to take it away. So as we learn that you can't be happy, and you'll get to the point where, yeah, you're losing weight and you're very healthy, but you are so sad. So because I study cannabinoids, and because states like yours have made marijuana legal, drug companies know now that, you know what, when it's legal throughout the whole states, and they know it's coming, they're trying to get ready. So one of the companies I've been working with is making this really interesting drug. Since you already know about anandamide, anandamide's inactivated by reuptake. They made a selective anandamide reuptake inhibitor. Kind of cool. So that means every time you release some anandamide, your brain's endogenous marijuana, it stays in the synapse and tickles the receptors for a little longer, makes you a little happier. So what they've done is they know that they can't compete with real marijuana, so they're making things Mother Nature never thought of. So this is going to be a pill that you take, and nothing happens until you have a happy thought. You go, you know, you smile, and it's like, wow, that was a little better than average. And then, you know, and then you have a little bit more happy thoughts. And after a while, as you keep having happier and happier thoughts, you're going to make yourself high from one pill. That's where they're going. So they're gonna beat out marijuana in a really subtle way that you'll have to buy from them. It's amazing. There's more of these things out there. So I've been testing them in animals, and they're equally effective to THC in terms of reducing brain inflammation. So they're good for you from the brain standpoint in that they protect you from oxygen and the things oxygen does, but they're things that you're gonna have to pay for, because right now marijuana is just too darn cheap and nobody can patent it. So, you know, just like stay tuned in the next 5-10 years. The drugs out there are just going to be so interesting, you know. Anyway, yes, go ahead. I don't know who is next. Go ahead. Hi.
Hello. My name is Anna, and I'm having difficulty in understanding the protection from oxygen when, if we don't have it, we die very quickly.
You're right.
And I wonder if part of it is the difference between oxidation and oxygen. And we're largely water, for example, mm-hmm. H2O, mm-hmm. oxygen.
Yes.
So, as I said, I don't quite get that. And the other thing I'd like to say with the idea of food and drugs and chemicals being equivalent or synonymous, mm-hmm. I think there needs to be the differentiation between synthetic and natural.
Oh, wow.
Because then drugs and chemicals are not.
Oh, we don't make. I understand your point completely. We don't make that distinction at all anymore, and your brain can't tell the difference.
Yes, they can.
Well, really?
I mean, when you're.
Wow. Okay. I'd love to know what's been your experience with that.
No, well,
then.
In terms of, it's not medical. I'm a certified lymphologist.
Okay.
And. We are ingesting toxins that our bodies are considered foreign and sending out the troops to fight these things. We're thinking we're taking mm-hmm. in nutrition, but we're not. And it's overtaxing our organs, for example.
Uh-huh.
So that's why.
Such as? Could you give me an example?
Statement, such as?
Oh, what toxin? I'm sorry.
Any toxins. I mean, GMO foods.
Oh, those aren't toxic.
Pardon?
Those are not toxic. I know people would like to think so, but honestly, they're not. They're not. They're just chemicals. Really.
But I'm saying if you don't differentiate between natural and synthetic.
What would be a synthetic?
And if your brain, I don't know, but our body recognizes the difference between synthetic
and not. Can you give me an example?
Our taste buds don't recognize the difference. But our body does.
How? Can you give me an example? I mean, I just love to know.
Something that is toxic?
Yeah.
Vaccination causes autism.
Oh, don't listen to him. He will be dead soon anyway, ahead of you.
All of those synthetic chemicals that are in our processed foods.
There's a lot of chemicals in there.
Metabolize them. And that's the other thing, when you talk about sugar and salt, we need minerals. Vitamins don't mean anything without the minerals. Salt, I'm not talking about more than salt.
Which salt or which vitamins are you talking about though with minerals?
Any vitamins. Vitamins in our, that's why we eat, you know, to get vitamins. Okay. That's why we eat the different colored foods, because they got different vitamins in them. Right?
Some do, yeah, sure.
What do you mean some do? Well, if they're GMO, yes, I can see a lot don't.
Okay, but is there a question, though? I mean,
no, well, I was just saying that it said I had difficulty in making and understanding protecting ourselves against oxygen.
Yeah, yeah.
And again, I can understand if we're talking about calories and oxidation. Well,
the first point you made about the water, we are a lot of water, you're right, and that is oxygen. It comes in many different forms. I mean, it obviously in us. The one I'm talking about is just mostly oxygen, the gas that we bring in.
That's right, which if this room was removed of it,
you'd
be
die.
Gone.
Yeah, that's...
So to be protected from it, again, that...
Oh, yeah. Let me give you an example. You remember probably we're old enough...
Polluted air, yes.
Yeah, but we're both... We're both probably old enough to understand. Remember the days when we used to put young kids in hyperbaric oxygen when they were born, and it did save their lives, but it also made them blind. The oxygen actually destroyed the cornea, and that was part of the problem. The cells, if the oxygen levels get too high, it kills our cells. This is what hemoglobin's good for. It keeps the levels down. But I'm happy to. Oh, sure, sure. Glad you brought it up. Yeah, go ahead.
Hey, so you talked about how, when many people want to go to Starbucks or a coffee shop and have their caffeine and that wakes them up and then they're happy. So young people, kids or other people who have chosen not to go the caffeine route for whatever reason, don't seem to necessarily need, I have young kids and they don't need caffeine to be awake in the morning. So
they're lucky.
I'm wondering, kind of where does that come from? And or once you go there, can you not come back? Because then there are people who feel like if they don't have their morning coffee, they're messed up. Is that just another addiction that, you take away?
Oh,
I just was curious when you were talking about that, if there's anything to say.
There's two things there. They're really profound things. One is that depends on your genetic makeup. Some of my students, this always comes up, some of them have tried cocaine and they never tried again. This always is it. If we make cocaine legal, how many people become addicted to it? About the same number who get addicted to nicotine or anything else, about a third of the population. We carry genetic vulnerabilities in some people. They touch cocaine, they're gone. They'll never avoid it. Others, as when I talk to my students about this, is that, I tried it. It was nice. I don't need to go back to it. We inherit a genetic vulnerability. We understand that now. We can see the gene it's even tied to. And we can see why men tend to be see it more often than women. In fact, men even have a bigger boost of dopamine in response to methamphetamine than women do, which is why they become more addicted. So we can unpack those things. But let's go back to the young child. The interesting thing about why they're so wide awake, and this relates to a question I always get because I study aging. People always want to know, at what point do I start aging? Well, you start aging this when something about your brain starts to fail. Let's go with that. And the first thing that fails is sleep. So at puberty, you have your best sleep. And after puberty, sleep degrades. And we all know that, don't we? I mean, so that's the first point at which you really start aging. So young kids are as wide awake in as deep a sleep as they'll ever be, which is why you see bedwetting. They become so far asleep, they lose control of their sphincters. So what happens then is they get older and their sleep pattern degrades, and then they're like the rest of us, and it just gets worse and worse and worse. And as we get older, we lose REM sleep. And this is one of the things I was studying, was to find out what is it about losing sleep cycles, sleep patterns that are so critical, that we can regenerate. One of the things that happens as you get older is you lose stage four. You go into stage four first thing in the evening when you fall asleep, where you release wound healing hormones and things like that. And you're going to be resting, so it's a good time to release them. But as you get older, we don't heal from wounds as well because we don't go into stage four. So if we can take drugs that get us in there, it helps. We have no drugs like that. But what we do have is the ability to target the systems that are degenerating as we're aging. One of the biggest changes that we all notice is memory problems. It turns out that we always warn young women who are pregnant, don't smoke marijuana, because there are marijuana receptors on stem cells that undergo neurogenesis to make the brain. And if you have marijuana in the brain when the brain is young, it interferes with development. What my studies have been looking at is at the other end of the age spectrum. Turns out that as you get older, you lose REM sleep. You become more depressed because of that, and you have less of a hormone called BDNF and more inflammation, and neurogenesis goes to zero. What we found was the equivalent of one puff a day of marijuana, that's all, was enough to stimulate the marijuana receptors that are still on those stem cells, restate neurogenesis, brings back BDNF, and they started being smarter and they had better sleep patterns. So it's kind of a crazy thing to say. This is actually the point that she was making before. Some of the things that we believe are toxic can sometimes have these other actions on us that we want. And we have to separate those things. So one of the epidemiological studies we found is that people who smoke cigarettes almost never get Parkinson's disease, even when you correct for the fact that they might get lung cancer. Well, it turns out that cigarette smoke is a very powerful heavy metal chelator. So you inhale that smoke and you blow off heavy metals. Well, if you're working in a mine, you might want to smoke cigarettes. Or if you grew up in rural Kentucky, you might want to smoke cigarettes because the nicotine is neuroprotective. But if you take too much nicotine, it will kill you. So we live in a balance. And so the epidemiological studies have shown us that if we pay attention, we can see already a proof of concept. Some things that are very toxic can be very safe at the right level. And so we're trying to figure out what's the lowest dose of marijuana for an older brain to prevent them from developing the inflammation and the cell loss. Because at a young brain, it's very different. I would never recommend a child do this, but as a person over the age of 50, a puff a day might be incredibly beneficial. You know? So it's really tough sometimes to answer these questions. You always have to say, well, who are you? Male or female? Tall or short? Big or fat? What is your genome like? And all those things play a role. Anyway, who is next? Sir, yeah, go over here. Yes, hi.
Hello. So my question, you said that the bugs in our gut are basically oblivious to our existence.
Yep.
So to me, that means that our brains have no control over our gut. But I've learned, told,
yeah, go ahead.
That when we're eating and we're angry or we're sad or we're stressed, and mm-hmm. I mean angry, not chocolate angry, but an external
sure.
impact,
sure. Somebody,
that we are yeah. unable to digest the nutrients as well. So is there a science to that? Or
no, you're right.
Or is the no. are the bugs just totally working on their own and our brains have no impact over the
No, it's
the
a two-way street. You're okay. right, absolutely right. For the most part, we're just, it's like we're living on a planet that might be, you know, people talk about this in science fiction, our planet's just one little atom in the body of a giant creature or something, and we don't notice them, and they don't play a role in it. But you know what? There is a two-way street here. They do not work in isolation. If you had a close friend who was angry with you and critical of you and told you you were ugly and unpleasant, no one loved you, after a while, you would become depressed to the point you would need medication to treat an imbalance. We used to call those things serotonin-affecting drugs. We now know that Prozac is actually an anti-inflammatory, and what it's doing is it preventing what the bugs are doing in your brain. And the inflammation reduces BDNF, and this is why people turn to marijuana sometimes, to rebalance that. So how can you rebalance your bugs and make yourself feel happy? Yeah, You can imbalance it. In fact, now what we're beginning to think about, and this has actually started down the road in a frightening ways, is that let's say you're depressed or you have Crohn's disease, let's be more severe, where you're in pain, and that oftentimes causes inflammation, which produces a lot of anxiety and changes their mood. It does affect how you feel. So what we're thinking of doing is that since probiotics are not sufficiently complicated, the new treatment that's being tested for Crohn's and irritable bowel disease, and we think we can push it even as far as something like depression, are fecal transplants. So you actually take your spouse who lives in your environment and eats your food and so forth, and you get a big bolus of their fecal material, and you get a lot healthier from that, which makes dating really more complicated than it ever should be. And in fact, the most interesting thing now is some colleagues of mine at a drug company, they're actually making fecal tablets because people found this sounds crazy to me. I would go with the fecal transplant, but they have pills you can take, and you take a bunch of them, and you just swallow them down, and it's literally just the poop from your husband or wife, because it's the best source of a balance that would be best for you. So yeah, we have great evidence of what you're saying is absolutely true, and we've taken to the point now we're gonna try and correct it by taking advantage of that knowledge. It's amazing, you know, it's kind of scary, but if it's a great resource, you know. Anyway, did you have another question?
Oh, yeah. I'm just curious what impact our emotion can have on, if the emotions have any impact on the bugs, I guess.
You know, I can tell you that we have evidence that the bugs have an effect on your emotions, but proving the reverse is really tough because it's so darn expensive. The complexity of the bugs in the gut that coming out in the fecal material is so great that we have to do these genetic sequencing studies and find out who they are and as they change in their balance. And that's coming in at about $30,000 to $40,000 for a single person's analysis. It's just so expensive. It'll get cheaper, and we may be able to answer your question in the future, but right now, we just can't do that. All we can now say is that when we induce an imbalance, because sickness behavior looks so much like depressive behavior in the symptoms, what we think it really is, depression is just an imbalance of your bugs. And we give you an anti-inflammatory that we used to call SSRIs, that balances them and your brain out of the inflammation they're generating until you have time for them to readjust. So eat some probiotics or take some fecal transplants, whatever it is, you're gonna be happier soon, okay? This is why we now understand that 95% of all depression is spontaneously remits, because after a while, the bugs rebalance themselves and you get happier. So there's every reason to believe that what you're speculating on is true. We just don't have all the data to prove it yet. Okay, yeah. Yes, sir. Oh, really? Okay, all right.
Okay, quick question. You had mentioned color in produce, fruits and vegetables, as being one marker of something that's good for the body.
Yeah.
Are there any other simple markers that laymen can keep in mind when shopping in the grocery store?
Wow, that's pretty, color, literally color.
But is there anything other than color?
Oh my God.
And that's a good one, but is there anything?
Yeah.
Because I mean, I don't eat the banana
or
peel.
Other things. You know,
but, you know, so is there anything other than
sometimes
color?
There are hidden things. We know that some spices, for example, cinnamon in particular is really high in antioxidants. The highest thing that's like off scale is pond scum.
But I don't see that in the grocery store.
Yes, you do. They changed the name. You might have heard of spirulina. Yeah. That's pond scum. So, because no one wants to eat pond scum. But they don't mind eating spirulina, you know what I mean? So they gave it a cute name. That's what it is. And think about what it's like to be a pond scum. You're laying out there, and the sun is hitting you, and oxygen is bathing on you. You got to have a lot of protection. So what we do is consume their protection. So yeah, spirulina, those kinds of things, they work nicely.
Okay. Any other markers, though, for...
Other than color? No, not that I'm aware of.
Like texture or fatty content?
No, not usually, because it's usually the surface things. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right.
That I'm aware of. Okay. Well, thank you, everyone, for your great questions.